Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim.
ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. وبعد, الله سبحانه وتعالى in the Quran tells us, وتوكل على الحي الذي لا يموت وسبح بحمده وكفى به بذنوب عباده خبيرا. Have reliance, do rely, have reliance on Allah, on the one that's ever living, the one that does not die, the one that does not change. Everything else in this world around us is changing. So have reliance on the one that's ever living, that does not die, and glorify him and praise him. And it suffices of him as a knower of the sins of his own slaves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us while going to through this journey of this life with everything around us, never to lose focus, to always stay focused on one, the one that does not change. Everything around us will change. Everything around us will perish. كُلِّ شَيْءٍ هَالِكٌ إِلَّا وَجْهَهُ. Everything is going to perish except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything, be it a human being, feelings. Today I'm happy, tomorrow I'm sad. Today it's cold, tomorrow it's sunny. Today someone is born, tomorrow someone is dying. Everything around us as we pass through this journey of this life is changing. And for a believer, one of the concerns when I'm going through this journey of this life with things changing, it's easy to get distracted. It's easy to lose focus and to start relying and attaching my heart to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The focus of a believer is on one thing, his heart. How is my heart doing? When somebody praises me, how did my heart move? When somebody says something bad against me, how did my heart move? What comes out from my heart? My actions, the way I react to things, is an image of how I am internally. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ كُلٌّ يَعْمَلُ عَلَى شَاكِلَتِي. Everyone acts the way he is internally. And that's the definition of khuluq. How is my manners? Is my response one of patience, one of being humble? Or is it a response of arrogance? Or is it a response of anger? The focus of the believer is, how steadfast is my heart? How is my heart doing on this journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Did I lose focus? My end is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى. Whatever you decide to do, your end is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But through this journey, I want to stay focused. I want my heart to be focused on Allah. A heart focused on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will react in a beautiful way. The deeds coming from that heart will always be beautiful deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to help us in this journey, He sent to us a guide. The destination is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The guide through this journey is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He sent him as a guide to mankind, huda, to guide us. Going through this journey, I want to follow the footsteps of the Prophet, peace be upon him. To be on his footsteps, in his shade. When we say following the Prophet, it's not only outwards, but rather I want my heart to be where his heart was. I want to look. He too passed through the journey of this life. He was subjected to different things. But I want to look how, not only how he reacted outwardly, where was his heart? Is my heart where his heart is? Do I have a heart that's close to the heart of the Prophet? What manners, what characteristics, what khuluq of the Prophet? And am I reflecting the same khuluq or not? We will go quickly through the life of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and see how we can attach ourselves to the heart of the Prophet, peace be upon him. That will aid us in this journey. When you take a journey, if you have a guide, that's a lot of help. It will help you reach your destination faster, easier. Looking at the Prophet, peace be upon him, loving the Prophet, peace be upon him, allows us to follow him. Following the Prophet, peace be upon him, will lead us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He too was subjected to this life. And he is a role model for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Surely in the example of the Prophet, peace be upon him, you have an excellent, a most beautiful example for those who believe in Allah and wants to meet Allah and are hoping for the hereafter and are doing a lot of dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, he too passed through the journey of this life. And surely his life was not a life of ease. Rather, he passed through many, 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 many states. And as we go quickly through it, all of you know, when he was born, many of us, when we were born, you get to say, Daddy, Baba. But the Prophet, peace be upon him, when he was born, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best of mankind, he was an orphan. He never saw his father. He never saw his father. But it doesn't end there. As he's growing up, at the age of 6, his mother takes him to Medina. Why? So he can visit his in-laws or his relatives, and he would see the grave of his father. Can you imagine at the age of 6, a kid at the age of 6, and you tell him, this is the grave of your father? That's our Prophet. And it doesn't end there. On the journey, on the way back, from Medina to Mecca, 100 miles out of Medina, he was with his mother and Umm Ayman, her servant. His mother falls sick. And he sees that. My mother is sick. And surely enough, his mother dies. His mother dies. He loses his mother in front of his own eyes. And I ask you, who do you think buried his mother? It was him and Umm Ayman. Can you imagine? He witnessed his mother being buried. Did he help? Did he carry his mother? Did he help Umm Ayman? Can you imagine a 6-year-old kid seeing in front of his own eyes his mother dying and being buried in front of him? Death. For those of us who lost a loved one, for those who lost a father or a mother, for those who are orphans, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. You had a good example in the Prophet, peace be upon him. His life, he went back and he goes to his grandfather. And what happens? At the age of 8, his grandfather dies. Again, this is the life of the Prophet. This is what he has to pass through. His grandfather dies, then his uncle takes care of him. But his uncle, he doesn't have much money. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, was forced to have a low income job, if you will. He had to work as a shepherd. The Prophet, his childhood is... This is the childhood of our Prophet. But look at that. How did he change? Many of us, if we pass through this, I mean, we need therapy. What will come out? Will I hate society? You'll be worried about your kid. He passed through so much. The Prophet, peace be upon him, when he married Khadija, radiallahu anha, and life changed, things changed around him. And then all of a sudden, he had now wealth and everything. Look at what he did. He used to go into the ghar, into the cave. Why? Contemplating, where is the truth? And look at the lesson. Look at his heart. What is he? Many of us, if I lived such kind of a life, a life of deprivation, I lost my father and I lost my mother. The moment the life of this world opens its gates, what happens? Alhamdulillah, khalas, let me enjoy. The Prophet, peace be upon him, was not distracted when the life of this world opened its gates unto him. He was still, what are you doing in a cave? The bigger questions of life, where is the truth? Where is al-haq? Seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Truthfulness in seeking Allah. Being truthful in seeking Allah. No matter what happens, ease or difficulty. Some of us, when the life of this world opens unto us and we're so busy with work, what do? I don't have time to go to the masjid now. Is it? When was the last time I did i'tikaf? When I get so busy, that is why I have to go to the masjid. The Prophet, peace be upon him, when he was doing well and life was... He went for i'tikaf seeking the truth. Where is the truth? And when it came finally to him, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to him, and when he finds Allah finally, a heart that's yearning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the most difficult things happened to the Prophet, peace be upon him. What is it? The commandment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُدَّثِّرِ قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ. When you find the truth, when you are seeking something so much in your life, and you find it, you know what? I don't want to leave. Alhamdulillah, I found Allah. Let me worship you. But Allah tells him, no, stand up. Go and get people. Go tell people. Go bring them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Deliver the message to them. Why was that difficult? Because what will happen? When now he goes back to tell the one that's truthful, trustworthy, that people praised and known to be trustworthy among people, now he has to go and tell them to go back to Allah. And how was he received by people? You all know. When he starts telling them about Allah, they not only reject him, they started abusing him. Abu Jahl comes to him one time and he tells him, Ya Muhammad, what do you want? You want me to witness in front of your Lord that you delivered the message? I will. If I know you're truthful, I'll follow you. وَلَكِنَّكَ كَذَّابٌ. But you're a liar. the most truthful. He's told, can you imagine how hard that is? If you work in a company for 20 years and being honest, known to be honest, and here comes an employee and tells you, you are a liar, you are a thief. What reaction comes from my heart? How will I'll be angry, I'll be upset. How dare you say that? Did the Prophet do that? You find in the Quran, where was the Prophet's heart? Rather, his concern was what he was concerned for Abu Jahl. He was concerned that he's not delivering the message well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals in the Quran, قَدْ نَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا يَحْزُنْكَ الَّذِي يَقُولُونَ فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يُكَذِّبُونَكَ وَلَكِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ يَجْحَدُونَ We know that it grieves you, that they belie you. It grieves him. He is grieved that people are rejecting him. But those people, they know that you're truthful. They are denying the signs of their Lord. Those are ungrateful people. But it doesn't stop there. His own uncle, Abu Lahab, walks behind him. Whenever he tries to speak to people to deliver the message of Allah, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the truthful, the one honored in the heavens and earth, his uncle beside him, and when he tries to speak, his uncle say, don't believe him, I raised him up, I'm his uncle, he's a liar. Can you imagine if I'm giving this khutbah today, and my father is beside me, and whenever I speak, and my father would look at me and tell you guys, don't believe him, I raised him up, he's my son, he's a liar. What will come out from my heart? How dare you say, I'll be angry, I'll be... The Prophet, peace be upon him, did he stop? Did he get... He continued delivering the message. الثبات على الأخلاق, steadfastness, compassion towards mankind, did not stop, continued. And when he did not stop, now they want to stop him. So they figured another way. Abu Lahab starts, okay, I'm going to hurt him in his own kids, in his own daughters. Ruqayya and Umm Kalthum, they were both, they had their kitab and they were going to be married to the sons of Abu Lahab. He orders his sons, Utba and Utayba, divorce them. The daughters of the Prophet got divorced. They got divorced. He wants to hurt. I ask you, am I subjected to that? If, wallahi, look, think about it yourself. If saying the truth is on one side and having a divorce on another side, which one will you favor? Big lesson. The Prophet, peace be upon him, did he stop? He has to see now, not his daughters are getting divorced because he's speaking. He did not stop. He continues delivering the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-thabat ala al-akhlaq, being steadfastness on manners and good characteristics. He has to deliver. Even if his own daughters, many of us, you know, I can take things, but when it comes to my kids, no, not my daughter, not the future of my kids. The Prophet had to witness his daughters in a most ugly way being divorced. For those in our community who witness their daughters being divorced unjustly, for sisters who are being unjustly treated and are being divorced, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. You had a good example in the Prophet, peace be upon him. You are on the footsteps of the Prophet. Be steadfast like him. And when he was steadfast, they did not stop. Look at what they did. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, loses his son. And you know the Prophet, peace be upon him, and his compassion. He loved his son. His son dies. When somebody loses his son, if my enemy loses his son, I have respect for that. I know what it means to be a father, how difficult it is to lose a son. But in the case of the Prophet, peace be upon him, they use that as an opportunity. They use that as an opportunity to hurt him and his wife. They started saying, Muhammad is abtar, Muhammad is amputated, he has no more kids, it's his wife. His wife can't deliver boys anymore. They use this to hurt him. Can you imagine Khadija? Now she's old, she cannot give birth anymore. He had to see that, being mocked and made fun of, and his wife is being abused, even when his kid dies. But he does not stop. He continues delivering message. They, on the other hand, now start to get physical, as you all know. And one time, as many of you know, he's praying. A person, you have respect for someone who's praying. Someone who's praying at the Kaaba, making sujood. And the kuffar, those people, they so wicked, they got the intestines of a camel. You know what it smells like? What's inside an intestines? Do you have any clue how it's... And they throw it on top of him. And it's said by the companions, they were laughing so hard, they were going to fall out of laughter. The companion that saw this said, I could not dare remove it. I can't. Who removed it? The Prophet remained in sujood. And the intestines is on top of him. His daughter Fatima rushes out to her father, crying, removing the intestines. If I see this, if this happens to me, what comes out of my heart? The Prophet, peace be upon him, sees his daughter 6-7 years crying, removing the intestines and crying, what are they doing to my dad? He tells her, Ya Fatima, la tabki. Inna Allah la nasiru abaki. Oh Fatima, do not cry. Allah is surely going to bring victory to your father. That is yaqeen. Those are beautiful words from a heart that's very well connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even when harshness comes from outside, it is steadfast. The output is what? One of certainty. One of, this is reliance. At that moment, can you say this? Inna Allah la nasiru abaki. But then things get really difficult. And they start to torture his companions. He had to witness the best of his friends, the companions, those who believe, the likes of Bilal. Bilal ibn Rabah. Who is Bilal? Mu'adhin al-Rasul? You know what they did to him? They throw him in the desert with a stone on him. They even put a rope on his neck, gave it to kids, drag him in the city like a dog. Make fun of him. The Prophet saw that. The likes of Ammar ibn Yasir, they kill his mother and his father and they torture him. And he comes to the Prophet telling him, Ahakad al-Dahr, are we going to stay like this for the century? Khabbab ibn al-Arat, you know what they did to him? He says they got him in the desert and they placed him on charcoal. You know charcoal, you know when you barbecue, you know how hot it is? They placed Khabbab ibn al-Arat on top of the charcoal. And he says, nothing extinguished the charcoal except the melting fat of my back. He had holes in his back. And he goes to the Prophet, peace be upon him, telling him, أَلَّا تَدْعُوا لَنَا أَلَّا تَسْتَغْفِرْ لَنَا. Don't you make dua for us? Don't you يعني ask Allah for us? What comes out from the heart of the Prophet, peace be upon him? He said his face turned red. And he told him, people before you, they were cut into half and they were steadfast on their deen. You are hasty. Be patient. Patience. It is very easy for me to stand here and tell you, brother, be patient. It's very easy. But in that condition, that is true patience. That's a heart that is indeed patience. Has patience, full of patience. Full of that. And it does not end there. As you know, they collect all of them and they throw them in Sha'b ibn Abi Talib. Everyone, the Prophet and all who supports him. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, has to witness what his uncle was old. Khadija, she was old. They could not take this boycott. No food, no water in the desert. Khadija dies. And now his uncle dies. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, sees that. No food, no drink, nothing. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas remembers this. And he says, he remembers those days and he said, one day I was so hungry, I was walking and under my feet I felt something soft. I grabbed it and I swallowed it. I don't know what I swallowed. The companions of the Prophet had to go through this. Did that change them? Did they leave the truth? Never. Steadfastness under akhlaq. This is our role model. They continued. The Prophet, peace be upon him, continued. And some of us might say, you know what, sometimes it's very easy to be forgiving when we're weak, right? But you look to the Prophet, peace be upon him, what was his attitude, one of weakness? Nah, by Allah, never. Look at the Qur'an revealed in this period. How was it like? Was it apologetic? No. Verses, and Surah Al-Qamar, for example, أَمْ يَقُولُونَ نَحْنُ جَمِيعٌ مُنْتَصِرٌ سَيُهْزَمُ الْجَمْعُ وَيَوَلُّونَ الدُّبُرُ. The Qur'an in this period was threatening the disbelievers. The Muslims are surrounded, they're going to be wiped out. And the Quran speaks in such amazing, it's a miracle. It is a miracle, really. You cannot say those kind of words in this moment. The Quran tells the mushrikeen, are they going to say that because there's so many, they're going to be victorious? No, tell them they're going to be defeated and they're going to run away. When Umar ibn al-Khattab heard this verse, he heard this verse at this time, you know what he said? Ayyu jam'in hadha. What are you talking about? What kind of group? How? It's not doable. How can you speak like this? At the Battle of Badr, when they were defeated and they were running away, Umar ibn al-Khattab said, and the Prophet said the verse, سَيُهْزَمُ الْجَمْعُ وَيَوَلُّونَ الدُّبَرُ. Umar ibn al-Khattab said, أَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. I bear witness that you are the Prophet of Allah. The Quran in this moment, the verse is like, رُبَمَا يَوَدُّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْ كَانُوا مُسْلِمِينَ. Challenging the disbeliever, telling them a day will come where the disbelievers will wish they were Muslims. How can you say that? What courage? What steadfastness? What certainty? Even I'm looking to us, when we think we're weak, when we think we're oppressed, can we dare say those verses? Can you imagine? That's a heart connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the heart of our Prophet, peace be upon him. But they don't leave him alone, as you all know. When things turn and he finally immigrates, leaves Mecca for them, goes to Medina, they don't want to let him go. And you know what happened? Battles happened, the likes of the Battle of Uhud. They came after Medina, they want to extinguish this message. No, we're not. And what was he asking? What did he tell them? Stop saying bad things about me, stop calling me names. No, he didn't say that. He said one thing, خَلُّ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنِ النَّاسِ. Let me deliver the message. It's all what I want. Today, what are we busy with? Don't insult us, don't do this to us, don't. Are we free to deliver the message? Yes. He didn't even care to tell them, stop insulting me. He wanted focused on delivering the message. Today we lose focus. We always don't insult Muslims. Deliver the message, the doors are open. Follow the Prophet, peace be upon him. And they send an army. And you know the Battle of Uhud and what happened in the Battle of Uhud. When the Muslims were first victorious. And you know what happened when the archers left their position, did not follow what the Prophet told them to gain booty, and Khalid ibn al-Walid with the knights of the mushrikeen turns around the Muslims and attacks them from behind and says, "U'lu hubal," and Abu Sufyan noticed this, and now the Muslim army in the middle is attacked from the front and the back. At this delicate moment, and Muslims now are surrounded, the Prophet, peace be upon him, where was he? He was with nine of his companions, away from the midst of the battlefield. What came out from his heart? Something, sometimes we skip this. If you have a president of any country, and somebody tries to shoot the president, what is the first thing the bodyguards do? Push him in the car and take him away, right? Save the president. The Prophet, peace be upon him, when this happened, he could have, save him, take him back to Medina, that's the most important thing. What did he choose to do? No, he did not do that. He actually started announcing, إِلَيَّ عِبَادَ اللَّهِ, I'm still alive. Why did he say that? Because the mushrikeen announced, we killed Muhammad. And the Muslims were really panicking. So the Prophet saw that. And at this moment announced his position, gave up where he was, telling them, I'm still alive, come to me. When he does that, who heard him? You're announcing your position? The mushrikeen now heard him. And they started, everyone left the battlefield, and I want you to now focus on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he, in the most delicate point of his time, a very delicate situation, with nine of his companions, seven from the Ansar and two from the Muhajireen, and they start defending him. But surely enough, one after the other, the Ansar came out first, starting to defend the Prophet. They die one after the other. He sees that. And when the seven were killed, he was left with Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas wa Talha ibn Ubaidillah. What came out from his mouth? Was he scared? You know what he told them? He told them, مَا أَنصَفْنَا إِخْوَانَنَا. We were not fair to our brothers. We let the Ansar die. How can we? Can you imagine at this moment? This is what's coming out from his heart. We were not fair to those who died. And at this moment now he's exposed. And he's exposed to the attacks of the disbelievers. And the knights of the disbelievers started attacking him. And as many of you know, a knight by the name of Abdullah ibn Zuhri attacks him, hits him. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, hits him on the forehead, and the Prophet falls. And then he stands up again, and a knight, Abdullah ibn Qami'ah, one that hated the Prophet so much, he comes to him, he sees him, attacks, hits him on the shield, and the Prophet falls down. And it was said for 1 month, the Prophet complained about that hit. He stands up again, Abdullah ibn Qami'ah returns back to him, hits him on the helmet, and telling him, خُذْهَا وَأَنَا ibn Qami'ah, take this from me, I'm ibn Qami'ah. And it is said the helmet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his helmet went, the iron of the helmet went into his cheek, into the bones of his cheek, and blood starts gushing out. Another one comes with a stone. Can you imagine the Prophet, peace be upon him, and somebody throwing a stone in the face of the Prophet, peace be upon him? And the stone hits the Prophet, peace be upon him, and blood gushes out. Did anybody throw a stone at me? What will happen? I ask you. If somebody did this to you, what comes from your heart? You know what came from the heart of our Prophet, peace be upon him? And look at this heart connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rahmah lil alameen. He said, how can people that do that to their Prophet ever attain success? Allahumma ihdi qawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. Allahumma aghfir li qawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. Oh Allah, guide my people, for they do not know. Oh Allah, forgive my people, for they do not know. He was concerned that Allah is going to punish them. Do not punish them. What kind of rahmah? What kind of compassion? This is true compassion. At this moment, you're doing this. And they start attacking him left and right. And then the companions start rushing towards the Prophet, peace be upon him. And Ubayd ibn al-Jarrah, he is the one that came, and he said he saw the iron pieces in the face of the Prophet. And it was him, Ubayd ibn al-Jarrah, that said, I'll get it out. And he pulls one of them with his teeth. And he lost a tooth, bringing the iron out of the face of the Prophet. And there was another iron piece in the face of the Prophet. And Ubayd ibn al-Jarrah uses the other teeth, pulls it out, and he lost the other tooth. And now blood gushes out of the Prophet, peace be upon him, off his face. They could not stop the blood. You know who stopped the blood? Fatima. She came with burning straw, fire and straw. Our Prophet, peace be upon him, fire and straw at his face. It's the only way to stop the blood. Our beloved Prophet, peace be upon him. And then as he goes to the mountain of Uhud, later, you know what they did? They were not happy. So they started mutilating the bodies of his companions. And you know what they did to Hamza? And what they did to the companions? They cut the noses and the ears. And they made necklaces out of it. And they started hanging that on trees. If you enter to a masjid one day and you find this scene in front of you, what will you do? If you enter to a masjid and you find the people, the Muslims, their noses and ears are cut. And the companions couldn't take it. The companions looked to the Prophet, peace be upon him, and they told him, إِلْعَنْهُمْ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. O Prophet of Allah, curse them. Curse them. And in the hadith narrated by Abu Huraira in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, لَمْ أُبْعَثْ لَعْنَةً وَلَكِنِّي بُعِثُ رَحْمَةً. I was not sent to curse mankind. I was sent as a mercy to mankind. That's rahmah. That's compassion. He could have made dua, you have cursed all of them. You wouldn't have had people like Khalid ibn al-Walid or Amr ibn al-As. He is full of compassion, even towards the people that did that. Rahmah to mankind. And look at him, when he goes to the mountain of Uhud, what was the first thing he did? You look onto that. If that happened to me, I'll be concerned, will they attack Medina? Will they? The Prophet, peace be upon him. You know what the first thing he told them? Istawu. Why? We're going to pray. Salah. It's time for Salah. Even then, if you go back to your work and you have a letter, you've been laid off, are you going to remember Salah? It is time to pray. At this moment, when you've been injured, the Medina is like, and you've been defeated, and you remember Salah. And then after Salah, he tells them, Istawu, line up. Why? I'm going to thank my Lord. I'm going to praise my Lord. Praise my Lord. At this minute, you're thanking Allah after... This is thankfulness. This is a heart full of thankfulness. This is the heart of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It's a good time now to stop and make dua. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستغفره ونستعينه ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وبعد But things did change. Life was not always harsh for the Prophet, peace be upon him. When things turn around and he now is victorious and he is the most powerful and he is entering Mecca. Because sometimes it's easy to forgive and be merciful when you're weak. But when things turn around, what happens? Look at the heart of the Prophet. Now he's entering Mecca to those people that did all this to him. And as he's entering Mecca, he gives one of the flags to Sa'd ibn Ubadah, one of the companions. And he hears him. He says, Al-yawmu yawmul malhama. Al-yawmu tudallu Quraysh. Today is a slaughterhouse. Today, Quraysh is going to be humiliated. Finally, the Prophet, peace be upon him, takes the flag away from him. Gives it to his son. Tells him, no. Al-yawmu yawmul marhama. اليوم تعز قريش. Today is a day of mercy and compassion. Today Quraysh is going to be honored. And he enters Mecca. And you know how does he enter Mecca? Lowering his head in humbleness. When an army nowadays is victorious and they win, what do they do? How do they brag? The Prophet entered in humbleness, humility in this moment. Forgave everyone. But even then, forgiving everyone, some were not happy still. After he forgave everyone, a man by the name of Fudala was not happy with the Prophet, peace be upon him. And he decides to kill the Prophet, peace be upon him. And he gets a dagger, poisonous dagger, hides it inside of his abaya. And he walks behind the Prophet, and the Prophet, peace be upon him, is making the tawaf around the Kaaba. And he is full of rancor and hate. He wants to stab him. But the Prophet, peace be upon him, notices Fudala. And he looks to him. And he tells him, Ya Fudala, bima tuhadithuka nafsuk. Oh Fudala, what is yourself telling you to do? Innama azkurullah. I'm just remembering Allah. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, continues to walk. And Fudala is behind him, still intent to kill the Prophet, peace be upon him. The Prophet, peace be upon him, this time turns to him, smiles to him. Ya Fudala, bima tuhadithuka nafsuk. Oh Fudala, what is yourself telling you to do? Innama azkurullah. I'm just remembering Allah. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, puts his hand on the chest of Fudala. A chest full of rancor. A chest that has a dagger, poisonous dagger in it. And he tells him, Istaghfirullah ya Fudala. Istaghfirullah ya Fudala. Ask Allah to forgive you, Fudala. Fudala says, when he was placing his hand, he was the most hated person in my eyes. The moment the Prophet, peace be upon him, lifted up his hand, Fudala says, he became the most beloved person in my eyes. Today, we see the inheritors of Fudala around us with rancor and hate, poisonous daggers in their heart. Many of them I see outside wanting to stab the Prophet, wanting to... Where are the inheritors of the Prophet, peace be upon him? So they can too place their hand on their chest, so they can extract the rancor and anger from their chest and put inside the light of Nubuwwah. The Prophet, peace be upon him, changed people. He's light. His message is the message of light. The Qur'an is light. Allah is a nur. Today, the world is living in darkness. Where is the light of prophethood? His sunnah is here. The lights of prophethood is everywhere. Why don't people see it? Because the light of prophethood is reflected by the mirror of the hearts of his followers. We are the mirrors that reflect the light of prophethood. Sometimes a mirror can be unjust. Sometimes the light is there, but if the mirror is unclean, unpolished, filthy, dirty, you put it and people would look in it, the light is there and they will see the filth and they will see the dirt. And they will be saying, is this dirt coming from? What have we done? What have we done to this message? لِيَكُونَ الرَّسُولَ شَهِيدًا عَلَيْكُمْ وَتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. So that the Prophet will be a witness unto you, and you will be a witness unto mankind. Today we are a witness for mankind, against Islam. Where are we? How are we? Are we doing the same thing? Are we reflecting the light of Prophet? Are we changing people? The Prophet, peace be upon him, I'm going to leave you with this. He passed through many things. And he said in a hadith that I find one of the most amazing hadith, and it's in Bukhari in Muslim. لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ دَعْوَى مُسْتَجَابَ. For every prophet, there is a da'wah, a dua that Allah would respond to. You know, Prophet Nuh, إِنِّي مَغْلُوبٌ فَانْتَصَر. He made the dua, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send the showers of rain. Prophet Sulaiman, هَبْلِي مُلْكًا لَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحَدٍ مِنْ بَعْدِ. When he asked for a kingdom, nobody else will have. Every prophet has a dua that Allah will answer. He says that. لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ دَعْوَى مُسْتَجَابَ. تَعَجَّلَ بِهَا. But he was hasty to ask for it. وأردت أن أختبئ دعوتي شفاعة لأمتي يوم القيامة. And I choose to hide my dua, to save my dua, so I can intercede for my ummah on the day of judgment. The Prophet, peace be upon him, he passed through what he passed through. The companions passed through what they passed through. Why? So that the likes of me on the day of judgment, he can intercede for. Many of you sitting here say, oh brother, that's for the companions, for the righteous people, you don't know what I'm doing. No. Look at the other hadith. The companions say, كُنَّا نُمْسِكْ عَنِ الْإِسْتِغْفَارِ لِأَهْلِ الْكَبَائِرِ. We used to seize and hold from seeking istighfar and asking Allah to forgive those people who do major sins. Until we heard the Prophet, peace be upon him, saying, جَعَلْتُ دَعْوَتِي جَعَلْتُ شَفَاعَتِي يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ لِأَهْلِ الْكَبَائِرِ مِنْ أُمَّتِي. I made my intercession on the day of judgment for those people with major sins among my ummah. The one sitting here who think that you're the worst person, it is you. The Prophet was concerned about you coming later, and he's concerned. He could make dua, but he saved it because he knows what you need the most is on the day of judgment. He wants to intercede for me and you. He wants to be able to intercede for those among the ummah now that we sometimes cannot even look at. Oh, he drinks. Oh, she's not wearing hijab. Oh, Those are the people that the Prophet suffered and the companion suffered, and he delayed his dua so that he can intercede for. That is rahmah to mankind. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. It is Jum'ah, and I leave you with this. One of the best things to do in Jum'ah is to send peace and blessings on the Prophet, peace be upon him. And when you do it, remember the hadith, إن لله ملائكة سياحين يبلغونني عن أمتي السلام. If you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has angels. When you say Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Muhammad, the angels go and they deliver your salam to him. When we say Allahumma salli wa sallim, can you imagine now sitting in California and I say Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Muhammad? An angel goes to the Prophet and tells him, Hassan in California is sending you his salam. I leave you with this. Please don't be miser. A lot of salah and salam on the Prophet will lead to a love of the Prophet. Then we can follow the Prophet. Then we can stay focused. And then we can reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we will change people around us like he changed people around him. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين اللهم رد أمة محمد إلى لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وأقم الصلاة